हेलो एवरीवन, टुडे आई विल बी टॉकिंग अबाउट मैकेंजी मेथड डीरेंजमेंट सिंड्रोम। सो हेलो, आई एम डॉक्टर स्नेहा, एमपीटी इन ऑर्थोपेडिक्स एंड स्पोर्ट्स रिहैबिलिटेशन, इंचार्ज प्रिंसिपल एट लीड श्रीमती एस सी पटेल इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ फिजियोथेरेपी। सो एज वी हैव ऑलरेडी डिस्कस्ड इन माई प्रीवियस वीडियोज, देर अकॉर्डिंग टू MDT दैट इज मैकेनिकल डायग्नोसिस एंड ट्रीटमेंट, देर आर थ्री टाइप्स ऑफ सिंड्रोम: postural syndrome, dysfunction syndrome and derangement syndrome. So in today's class I will be talking about derangement syndrome. So the derangements respond to mechanical loading strategies in the form of repeated movements or sustained postures. Internal derangement causes a disturbance in the normal resting position of the affected joint surfaces. Internal displacement of articular tissue will cause pain to remain constant until such time as the displacement is reduced. Internal displacement of articular tissues obstruct the movement. So according to the derangement syndrome, they are saying that there is internal displacement of the articular tissues which will cause the pain, and as far as the internal displacement is present, the pain will remain constant. Derangement syndrome is the most common syndrome out of the three syndromes of Mackenzie. 80-90% of the cases coming to OPD will have the derangement syndrome. It is sensitive to loading strategies. So certain activities and certain postures during the day will increase their pain. It is dynamic. Dynamic in nature, as in pain behavior depends on activities and posture. So certain activities will be inducing the pain and certain activities will be releasing the pain of the patient. So derangement syndrome, characteristic of the derangement: sensitivity to loading strategies. That means there will be certain movements which will aggravate the pain and there will be certain movements which will relieve the pain of the patient. It is dynamic in nature. So maybe early in the morning patient will not have any pain. At the end of the day, after doing certain activities, patient might experience some pain. Symptomatic and mechanical presentation and responses: centralization and peripheralization will be seen in the derangement syndrome. There will be deformity, impairment also can be there, loss of function also can be there. Pain will be continuous. Derangement can be reducible or irreducible. Directional preference may be there. What is directional preference? That means suppose flexion is increasing the pain of the patient, then when the patient is attempting to do extension movement, then extension movements will be pain relieving for the patient. So that is called as directional preference. Different treatment principles and loading for reduction of derangement: there is extension principle, flexion principle, lateral principle, force progression and force alternatives. So broadly, the derangement syndrome can be categorized into two, that is reducible derangement and irreducible. Reducible derangement, loading strategies will be found that improve the symptoms as well as other loading that worsens the symptoms. So what will happen in case of reducible derangement syndrome? There will be one particular movement which will be aggravating the pain of the patient, and there will be opposite movement which will be relieving the pain of the patient. Irreducible means in this case only loading strategies that peripheralize, worsen or do not affect the symptoms are found. So here in irreducible derangement syndrome, loading strategy, we cannot identify particular loading strategies which can peripheralize, worsen the symptom of the patient. Clinical picture: mainly through the history taking, we have to ask the specific question during our history. So by history taking, we can come to know if the patient is having derangement. Spinal pain or radiating pain to thigh or leg. So in derangement, the patient may either come with localized spinal pain, or it is also possible that they may have radiating pain to thigh or leg. Paresthesia, numbness and myotomial weakness will be seen. Only in derangement, symptoms are referred into thigh or calf. So this is the characteristic symptom, characteristic feature of the derangement syndrome. In postural syndrome as well as in dysfunction syndrome, we do not see referred pain to thigh and calf. Symptoms may change over time and symptoms may vary during the course of the day or week. So it is possible, as I told earlier, that in the morning patient is not having any pain at all, and as the day progresses, by the end of the day patient starts having severe pain. So the pain can be constant or it can be intermittent. Phenomena of peripheralization and centralization is seen only in derangement syndrome. So peripheralization means the pain will start from the spine and it will radiate down into the thigh and the calf muscle as well as the sole of the foot. In centralization, what will happen? The symptoms will reduce over time. That means if maybe before the patient was having pain in the calf as well as thigh muscle, but after the treatment it is possible that patient will no more have the symptoms in the thigh and calf muscle, and only localized symptom in the spine will be there. So this phenomena of centralization and peripheralization is only seen in case of derangement syndrome. So the pain can be constant or intermittent in the derangement syndrome. Frequently the pain is constant in nature, no position gives relief, and dull constant ache is felt and aggravated by certain movements and position and is by different posture. Derangement syndrome physical examination, we can see that poor sitting posture will be found. Absent or reduced lordosis will be there. Irreducible derangement can be aggravated by repeated movements and sustained postures. So the criteria, history, local or referred pain will be there, possible paresthesia will be there, variable symptoms, centralization and peripheralization, and it can increase or decrease and it can change the side, the symptoms of the patient. It is possible that before they were having only one-sided pain, then in pain can also shift from right to left and vice versa. Pain will be constant and intermittent, mechanical pain will be there. Then onset can be associated with considerable functional disability. So functional disability also we will see in case of derangement syndrome. Physical examination, slouch sitting posture will be there. Postural correction affects the symptoms, reduced lordosis will be there. Deformity can be there, for example, lateral shift or kyphosis, or lordosis also can be increased or decreased. Loss of range of motion can be there. Positive neurological testing will be there, and repeated movements or sustained posture may produce, worsen or peripheralize the symptoms. Opposite repeated movements or sustained positions abolish or make better or centralize the symptoms. Repeated movements or sustained position decrease the range of motion, decrease the range of movement, and opposite repeated movements of sustained position increase the range of motion. So basically in physical examination, if the patient is having derangement syndrome, then patient will have directional preference. So in one position, either flexion or extension, one movement will be painful for the patient and the opposite movement will be pain-free for the patient. Management of derangement. So management consists of mixture of education and mechanical therapy. There are mainly four steps that we have to take into account for the treatment of derangement. That is reduction of derangement, maintenance of reduction, recovery of function, and prevention of recurrence. So first we have to do reduction of the derangement, then we have to maintain it, and then we have to recover the function, and then we have to prevent the recurrence of the back pain. So management, directional preference of the individual. So as I told, patient will be having pain in one movement and the opposite movement will be pain free. So we have to identify that which movements are pain causing for the patient and which movement the patient is having no pain. This is based upon the movement that abolish, decrease or centralize the symptom and restore mobility and function. The treatment principles are categorized as extension, flexion and lateral. Use patient generated forces only. Sometimes clinician generated forces also can be used. For reduction, key aspect, identification of treatment principle that centralizes, reduces or abolishes the symptoms and restores the function. Regular performance of self-management exercise until symptoms are abolished and function fully restored. So patient has to daily do the exercise every 2 to 3 hours. He has to do 10 repetitions at least. Force progression only necessary if no initial movement or improvement ceases. Re-evaluation of treatment principle only necessary if improvement ceases. So, suppose the patient is performing the exercises for few weeks and now there is no more improvement, then we have to re-evaluate the patient. Extension principle. So, when the extension principle can be used, onset may relate to flexion activity. That means the pain is only coming during the flexion moment, then we have to use the extension principle. Activities of flexion produce or worsen the pain of the patient or the symptoms of the patient. Activities of extension decrease or abolish the symptoms of the patient. Problems arise with curve reversal after prolonged sitting or bending. Physical examination, patient will have poor posture, slump sitting or slouch posture will be there. Posture correction affects the symptom. Lumbar lordosis will be reduced, there will be loss of flexion, greater loss of extension will be seen. Extension is obstructed and painful. Side glide movements can be minimal or no loss and little pain also can be there. Repeated flexion produces, worsen and peripheralize the symptoms. And repeated flexion worsens the mechanical presentation. Repeated extension will abolish, reduce or centralize the symptom of the patient. And repeated extension improves the extension reach. Kyphotic deformity also can be seen in some of the patient. Extension cannot be tolerated and flexion appears to bring temporary relief. So if these conditions are met, then we have to use the extension principle for the patient. So as you can see in the picture, first of all we have to give postural education. Sitting posture can be taught to the patient, then lying posture, prone lying can be practiced by the patient. In prone lying position, we can ask the patient to do back extension, and in standing also patient can do extension in the standing position. So this is the progression for extension exercises. Therapist overpressure can be given with the patient in prone lying position. Also use of belt also can be done. Lateral shift. So what are the indicators for the consideration of lateral component? Unilateral or asymmetrical symptoms, okay, and one or two. So indication for temporary abandonment of sagittal plane testing, peripheralization or worsening of peripheral symptoms in response to sagittal movements, non-response after full explanation of sagittal plane forces conducted over several days and or including force progression, and indication to avoid or defer testing of sagittal plane, presence of clinically relevant lateral shift deformity. So if scoliosis is seen and lateral shift deformity is seen, then we have to use the principle of lateral shift. So as you can see in this picture, patient can be made to stand against the wall and he can do the shift correction. In the last picture, you can also see that the therapist can put two hands over the opposite side pelvis of the patient and patient will be in standing position. The shoulder of the therapist can rest against the thorax of the patient and therapist can correct the lateral shift deformity. So again, this picture, self-correction, patient is standing against the wall and he is trying to correct the lateral shift deformity. Extension exercise, prone in extension, extension exercises in prone position also can be given to the patient. You have to also teach the patient correct sitting posture. Flexion principle, so when we have to use the flexion principle? Worse with activities of extension. In history, if the patient tells us that he is feeling the pain during extension movement, then we have to use the flexion principle. So pregnant or postpartum, rear end motor vehicle accident, prone slippers or possible risk factor for prone slippers, physical examination, accentuated lordosis will be seen, lordosis maintained in attempting flexion in standing, major loss of flexion, no loss of extension, deviation of flexion is possible, repeated flexion abolishes, reduces or centralizes the symptom of the patient, repeated flexion in lying may increase the flexion range, and repeated flexion in sitting increases the flexion range. So you can see these are the images showing flexion principle, how to use it. Patient can do in supine position, he can flex both hip and knee. In standing, he can do in one leg standing, he can also do the flexion movement. अगेन दीज आर द पिक्चर. थेरापिस्ट ओवर प्रेशर ऑल्सो कैन बी गिवन. सो दिस इज द प्रोग्रेशन. थेरापिस्ट कैन गिव ओवर प्रेशर वेन द पेशेंट इज इन सुपाइन लाइंग पोजिशन. वन हैंड इज ओवर द शोल्डर, अदर हैंड इज ओवर द नी ऑफ द पेशेंट एंड थेरापिस्ट अप्लाइज ओवर प्रेशर. सो रेफरेंस फॉर टूडेज वीडियो, आई हैव टेकन द कंटेंट फ्रॉम द बुक मैकेंजी वॉल्यूम 1 मैकेनिकल डायग्नोसिस एंड ट्रीटमेंट ऑफ लंबार स्पाइन. थैंक्स. इफ यू हैव एनी क्वेश्चन यू कैन कमेंट इन द कमेंट सेक्शन बिलो. Thank you for watching this video. If you have enjoyed watching this video, then please subscribe my channel and share it with your friends. Thank you.